in Diplo Thar Parker of the Great Indus Valley on 13th of June 1908 to the family of Mr. Habibullah Maimon, a star was born. And this child was named Muhammed Usman. Mr. Muhammed Usman Diplai, a renowned figure in the Sindhi literature and journalism, he authored over 150 books, innumerable short stories, articles, editorials and columns. He started his literary career at the age of 16 in 1925 and played a leading role in the emancipation of the Muslims of Sindh. He played a very significant role in the awakening of Sindhi Muslims and their rallying behind the Pakistan movement. After the creation of Pakistan, he focused his writings towards the eradication of social evils. He was founder editor of the prominent Sindhi Daily Ibrat, Daily Sindh Times, Weekly Insan and Monthly Saane Digest. His important literary works include but are not limited to Sindhi translation of the Holy Quran, comprehensive edition of the Risalo of Shah Abdul Latif Bhittai, Noor-e-Tawheed, Ataturk, Sangar and Inqilab-e-Iran. He was granted Pakistan Writers Guild Award for the best Sindhi novel Sangar for the year 1993 and for Inqilab-e-Iran for the year 1980. In recognition of his outstanding contribution to the field of literature, the President of the Islamic Republic of Pakistan awarded Mr. Muhammed Usman Diplai the President Award for Pride of Performance. His eldest son, Mr. Muhammed Ali Diplai, shares memories of his father.
My late father, Muhammed Usman Diplai Saheb, I can recall his memories right from 1942 when I was only 2 years old. We had just shifted to Hyderabad. And the basic cause of our shifting to Hyderabad was my very fragile health. I was born very sickly person, and the doctors at our small village Diplo advised us to shift to Hyderabad if my parents wanted me to survive. That forced my parents to come to Hyderabad, although it was too early, 1942. My mother was totally illiterate, and my father was working with Umarkot Zamindars, Khan Sahab Ata Muhammad Pali. He would pay weekly or fortnightly visit to Hyderabad, our home. I remember so many things from those days. And I can say very proudly that my father, though not a very highly educated or very rich person, but because of few books he had written by that time, he was always addressed to by the persons whom we met as Diplai Saheb. That was considered to be a big honor for us, and we were very proud. Although we were not very well-to-do, men of very limited means, but that thing never harassed us in any way. Once my father was addressed to by everybody Diplai Saheb, including his employers, but Khan Sahib Atawant Pali, he would also call him Diplai Saheb. So that was the great reward he was being showered upon by the entire Sindhi atmosphere, culture. I remember those days. And the things which I would like to highlight, that at about age of 5 years, I started reading Sindhi books. And my reading was so fast that I finished my primary book within a week's time. And I was yearning for reading and reading. And luckily, my father had very big collection of books. So I would always find some book or other of my age and of my taste. Some books only because of their good, beautiful covers. Some books because of some readable material. But when father noted this thing, he went to my primary school teacher. His name was Mirchumal. And asked him to bring all the books written in Sindhi, for Sindhi children, for my reading. So at the age of 5 or 6 years, I got a big collection of Sindhi books by Gulful Sahitya Academy. The books written by Milaram Vaswani, some 40 or 50 books. I still remember names of those books. Very interesting, very lovely books, very beautifully produced. And when at the age of 8 years, I started reading Urdu also. He brought magazines issued from Delhi, Khilona, and also he went to Karachi. He used to visit Karachi very frequently in connection with the printing of his books, and visited Feroz Sons, a very, very prominent name in Urdu literature, Feroz Sons, and bought some 50 or 60 books published by Feroz Sons for me. He was very kind, very generous, and he never for a second would refuse to bring anything which I desired or on his own for my nurturing. The second thing which I remember about my father, that as a journalist, he was very frequently called by press conferences, by chief minister's audience, and he would make it a point to take me along with him. And that was a time when I would see the ministers, I would see officers, and I became familiar with that culture, and all the fear or awesome nature of, fearsome and awesome nature of those big guns, it never then harassed me at any stage of my life. They were just as human beings as we are. So that was a big gift from my father. I remember many meetings called by Prime Minister, Chief Minister Khodo, Chief Minister Qazi Fazilai, Minister Qazi Akbar Sahib, and so many other important Chief Minister, Governor of West Pakistan, Mr. Gurmani. I remember those meetings. I was a boy of tender 10, 12 years old, age only. So these things I remember. He would take me to Karachi, and he would introduce me to the press. We had our own printing works by 1948, and he would allow me to visit various sections, the composing section, the printing section, the binding sections, the storing sections. So that's how we were more of like good friends. There was no traditional father or no traditional son. We were friends. I would discuss with him Muslim history, world history, and he would guide me. He would educate me in all these fields. His knowledge was immense. Although his source of information was mostly Urdu books, but if he would get any English book worth of reading, he had employed Mr. Sirajul Haq, the great Sindhi intellectual, as his English assistant. And his job was to translate English books for Diplai Saheb in Sindhi, so that he could read those books, particularly on evolution, on Russian literature and other literature. Siraj Saheb was the person who would translate for him. And that way, Siraj Saheb was also introduced, got introduction to literature that helped him to develop his intellectual level and ultimately appear in Central Superior Services Examination. And he would acknowledge that also. There he was introduced to Joy Saab, and then Joy Saab picked him for Sindhiyat Board. So these are strange phenomena of life. But father was like that. He would never hesitate to help anybody who needed his help by books or by jobs or by anything. Of course, during those days, poverty was there, so even small job mattered a lot. People were coming to Hyderabad, but in Hyderabad, where to go, what to do, what to eat, that was a great help. There were so many intellectuals who got jobs with Diplai Saab. Now they may laugh at it, but those were the days when anything, any abode, was a great support to those boys. Diplai Saab was only 15, 16 years old. In village Diplo, he had mastered Urdu language, Persian language, and Arabic language on his own. His formal education was only 5 primary classes, and thereafter for higher education, he had to go to Mithi, little bit away from Diplo during those days, and his parents were not willing to put him to that ordeal. But he acquired Urdu and Arabic, Hindi and Persian language very well. So his scope of acquiring knowledge was tremendous. And by age of, he was born in 1908, and by 1925, that makes 16 or 17 years, his first article appeared in Urdu magazine of Delhi, Ilmi Duniya. Surprising how he could acquire that quality of Urdu language and knowledge about Muhammad bin Qasim. He ventured to correct one article published in Ilmi Duniya, and that correction letter was so much liked by editor, very, very, very famous intellectual of India after time. He gave it a shape of article and published as independent article. Then his short stories started coming in Sindhi magazines of the time. By 1935, his first book appeared in Sindhi language. That won him literary prize from Sindhi Adibi Society, Muslim Sindhi Adibi Society. By 1938, his first Sindhi novel came in, and then a stream of books and magazines and so many things. Now, looking at his writings, it had 3 distinct phases. First phase was Ahiyae Millate Islamia and role of Sindhi Muslims in that upheaval. For about 10 years, till creation of Pakistan, his books appeared in support of Pakistan, in support of Muslim Millat. And after Pakistan, there was a big change in his outlook. He started writing books against Piri Muridi. In his view, there were 4 arch enemies of Sindhi people: Sindhi Vadero, Sindhi Peers, Sindhi business community, and Sindhi bureaucrats. He would not spare any of these class people. Dr. Hamida Kodo and Alimud Rashti have acknowledged in their research articles that the movement in support of Pakistan amongst the masses came not through the public meetings of politicians. It came through books written by Diplai Saab. But thereafter, he changed his pattern of attack on social evils. He started writing against Piri and Muridi very bitterly. Then came the time when one unit was in the offing, he became a radical Sindhi nationalist. At the same time, he was also influenced by the global struggle for socialism or social justice. He was attracted by communism also, but not so much as he was attracted by humanism, social equity and justice, and then Sindhi Muslims' emancipation, getting rid of one unit. All these books, mostly his books were banned in 1957. In 1958, when first martial law came, Ayub Khan's martial law, he was put behind bar for some time in Hyderabad, and then he was taken to Shahi Kila, Lahore. And then again in 1961, he was arrested by the government. And again in 1974, he was arrested by the government. Naturally, with the old age overpowering him, it was very difficult for him to resist all these torturous attitudes of the governments. One thing which really would be seen in all the books, all the phases, the Muslim Millat phase, or the Piri Muridi phase, or the Sindhi nationalism phase, or the world movement for equality and all these things. One thread lies common. He wanted to see the people rising up, breaking away the shackles, whether it was in the form of the British Empire, British imperialism, which had crushed Muslims everywhere, and as a reaction, it was the movement for Muslim Ahya, or it was the social inequalities imposed upon the Sindhi masses by the four classes of people, the peers, the vaderas, the bureaucrats, and the business community, or whether it was one unit being imposed by Sindhis, by the Punjab bureaucrats. The underlying theme was to how to get emancipation from this downtrodden status of social level among Sindhis. And not only Sindhis, and not only Muslims. Later, he was also writing for the emancipation of the downtrodden scheduled caste Hindus of the province. Anywhere, he was writing for the genocide of Muslims in Bihar, Jabalpur. He was writing for the blacks of Abraham Lincoln and the American emancipation of blacks. Wherever he would find anything wrong with the attitude of the ruling class or the social classes, he would write against it. How to write for the downtrodden people? In whatever form, in whatever way, he was not against the peers as such. He was their misdeeds. He was against their maneuvering of the poor people of Sindh. When time came, he wanted some hero. He created Pir Pagaro out of nowhere. He wrote his classical novel Sangar, in which he gave message to the world that Sindhis are not cowards. Sindhis are not as what they look. Sindhis are also very ferocious people. If there is some proper leadership available, they can fight to the nail. They can fight out any social inequality. It was through this Sangar that this message he gave, and people were surprised that this man was writing always against peers and Sajjad Nashin. How come that he is praising Pir Pagaro? He was praising that spirit. It was the bravery. It was standing for a cause. That thing of Pir Pagaro would symbolize Sindhi nationalism. That's why he got that book. People criticize that book, and still they criticize why he's talking in favor of peers. He's not talking in favor of peers. He never talked about all the peers of the Gaddi of Pir Pagaro. It was one person who sacrificed his life but never yielded. Rightly or wrongly, he stood by his ideals. That made him a great hero, Pir Pagaro. And Sindh needed heroes. Sindh still needs heroes. Sindh is misused by so-called fancy heroes of no use to Sindh. What to do, what to say. I wonder if he was alive, what he would write or what he would say about Sindh and Sindhis. Well, you know the position now. Well, if you study Diplai Saheb's writings from, let us say, after every 5 years, I find there was some big change. The first period is purely that of Islamic conquerors. Then second period comes to Mustafa Kemal. Now Mustafa Kemal was the person who finished Khilafat system in Turkey. So even now, our staunch Muslims don't like him. Although Turks call him Ataturk, but I haven't been able to find a publisher for Diplai Saheb's Mustafa Kemal, which is his best writing. Because Mustafa Kemal was nationalism. He saved Turkey from total collapse. So he was a nationalist. He never stood for Islam. He never stood for Muslims. Now, he writes his best books on Mustafa Kemal. Second books comes on Tipu Sultan. Again, he was not fighting for cause of Muslims. He was fighting for cause of Indians. Tipu Sultan was a phenomenon, but ahead of his time. Well, because of so many factors, he lost his life, and Mustafa Kemal became Ataturk. But the change in Diplai Saheb's writings 1945 and onwards was pro-nationalism, not pro-Ahya Islam. Well, the poetry of Allama Iqbal is still a very inspiring. It is a very, very big jungle where you find so many things, so many things. Shikwa jawab shikwa. You cannot get away from its magic. Shikwa jawab shikwa. Yeah, even you have not been able to find an alternative. Lab pe aati hai dua ban ke tamanna meri. So you can never condemn one person for writing this thing or saying this thing. You have to see his inspiration. He is also passing with you in different times. And he is getting effect from so many things around him. Sometimes, but the great thing which in him, that wherever, whatever inspired him, he never hesitated to express his feelings to the Sindhi audience. His audience was Sindhi, were Sindhi as a class. And therefore, I will tell you a very interesting thing. In Karachi, when we were living, my wife was a member of Sartian Sat. And in Sartian Sat, I'm wife of so-and-so, grade 20 officer, grade 19 officer, customs mein aaye, and you get a place in that Sartian Sat. But my wife said, I am daughter-in-law of Muhammed Usman Diplai. Then scores of old women would come and kiss her hand. And she was always surprised because Diplai Saheb's books were the only books which reached every Sindhi literate woman of those times. Okay, when reprinting of Diplai Saheb's books started sometimes in 2000, my publisher Sindhika, he was a little worried what book. Which book to start with? I asked my wife to consult her Sartian Sat and ask the old members the which book of Diplai Saheb they remember. And the reply came, Noor e Tauhid. So I again started reading that book. And believe me, while I was reading, I could not stop from crying. So powerful language. And that book has gone up to 5 editions. Now again, new edition is coming. The point which I am trying to make, the Diplai Saheb always wanted to inspire the woman folk of Sindh. He he wrote all the novels addressing the woman folk. That theme you will find in Sangar also. The emphasis is on the bravery and courage of Sindhi women, more than Sindhi men, Sindhi male. It was the women who carried the message of Sindhi nationalism. So that theme is from very first novel up to his last writing, to how to emancipate Sindhi women, because he was sure the only Sindhi woman can bring our nation up. Well, coming back to that Tehreek of Allama Mashriqi, what you call it, Khaksar Tehreek, he soon realized that it was German-inspired Tehreek. It was German-inspired Tehreek, and he, after a couple of years, he left it. And he was totally dismayed with the contribution of Allama Mashriqi. That's it. Same is true about, he was for Muslim League, but not for Muslim Leaguees. And then the final phase, Weekly Magazine Insan, the very first issue, carried title page, Abraham Lincoln. The man who fought against slavery. So that gave his mind that he was against human miseries, he was against human exploitation, whether color, whether religion, whether your beliefs, he was against all the slavery types. And according to him, he gave an interview in 1972, the worst form of slavery is imposed, is the slavery imposed by murshids on their followers, they control their minds. He was against it. But interestingly, he was pro Prince Karim Khan. He always praised his efforts for inculcating education all over the world and spreading education in his murids. So he was a free thinking man, and nobody could stop him from giving his ideas. The saying, kal tama hi cho likhyo, aj tama hi cho pe likho. No, not at all. Geets or ghazals in his dramas, Noor Jahan jo putr, ya Shayadi, and then occasionally current issues, way back in 1956 when President Iskandar Mirza became Pakistan's first president, then his wife, Naid Iskandar Mirza, she gave a speech that we will introduce Islam in Pakistan. So he wrote a poem, the Gun Gun Sando Gughat Thyo, Gadin Sando Gughat Thyo, Islam Chalu Tho Thi. That poem is recorded here. And that you can't call poetry for any specific purpose, just for, you know, momentary inspiration. I will not call them as shagirds. Well, mutual inspirations are, well, normal things. But he was moving from one circle to other very rapidly. This was the time, 1950, when he was introduced to Joe Saab. And Joe Saab then took him to another world altogether. Hyderabad Jatoi, Joe Saheb, and then Nizamani Saab hundo ho, leading socialist hundo, communist hundo ho, Nalum kun jo Zermani Krivio hai, Nizamani Saab ho, unhe je thuru jo ka Russian embassy mein introduced thi ho, so much so jo hiko dafo, Dan editor, again I forget his name also, he visited Russia, and then in his honor, a function was held at Aiwan-e-Dosti, Karachi. There, the function was presided by Diplai Saab. So he was so much well introduced to the Russian bureaucrats here, Russian embassy people here. So he was moving very rapidly. And he translated Maxim Gorky's book, Amar, in Sindhi. And another book by When the Steel Was Tempered in Sindhi. Another book, Dragon Seed. So he was very open person. Koryaji Kumar about the Korean Revolution. Japani Gudi about the resistance of Chinese people against Japanese aggression. Say, in that he was a perfect Sufi about his children and their future. He gave free hand to everybody. Whatever resources he had, they were all available to us. Now, unfortunately, I am without any brother. My two brothers died, younger brothers. All my sisters have died. I am all alone now. But he was very kind, very kind. Whatever he had, anybody, if reached him, his children or anybody from literary world for contribution, he would just put his hand, whatever would come out, it was just given to the person. Let it be son, daughter, wife, our friend, our student, the place of we are holding this function. So he was a very large-hearted man. He was not a man of this world. The immense popularity, the immense status he enjoyed, if he wanted to cash it, he would have been a multimillionaire. No. That, I should not say, but I had seen some very difficult days for him. And the hatred which I developed at that time for poverty stopped me from moving ahead in that intellectual world. Writer is a writer, no. Because I could see for a writer in this society, only difficulties are there. He can't get anything. Long after his death, perhaps somebody will recall him, and that too with the help of his children. Society itself will not give him any consideration. No. Ours is a very difficult society. Very difficult society. Said about Mirza Ghalib, Hum sukhan fahim hai. Hum sukhan fahim hai. Ghalib ke tarafdar nahi. You can apply that theory. Hum sukhan fahim hai. Ghalib ke tarafdar nahi. Well, he admired Sheikh Ayaz, but he was not his blind follower. Or he did not like orthodox religious people very much, but he was ashik of Haji Ahmed Malah. And when in one function Dr. Palod Sahab said that Haji Ahmed Malah is the greatest poet of modern times, Haji Ahmed Malah. So let me tell you, he was the first admirer of Haji Ahmed Malah way back in 30s. When he projected Haji Ahmed Malah in his dramas, and he was the first publisher of Haji Ahmed Malah's books, and he was a real staunch supporter of Haji Ahmed Malah. Now, what was the dividing line? The dividing line came way back in 1950s, mid-50s, then when one unit was being imposed on us. Now, that gave us a clear line of action. Baba, now we have to fight the fire. Our house is being looted. Our house is being burned. Now forget about your differences. This is the time to stand up. At that time came Sheikh Ayaz. After all, Sheikh Ayaz came in 55, 56. Before that also, we had poets. But then it was a time of Sheikh Ayaz. Now, then Sheikh Ayaz himself turned away. He became a very religious person. You don't accept that phase of Sheikh Ayaz. You only stick to his 50s and 60s time. It's your choice. Same, you don't give that allowance to Allama Iqbal. It's a pity. Allama Iqbal, jitro mazhab ke khilaf galayo hua hai, Sheikh Ayaz bhi kon galayo hua hai.
Sahi.
तव्हां केतिरो पढ़ियो आहे केतिरो कोन पढ़ियो आहे बट अलामा इक़बाल वॉज़ दी वर्स्ट एनिमी ऑफ रिलीजन बट देन ही न्यू दैट एट दिस टाइम अवर पेशेंट नीड्स रिलीजियस डोसेस एंड देयरफॉर ही बिकेम ए रिलीजियस पर्सन. Allama Iqbal's poetry is a very big collection of his Persian poetry is altogether different. Understand the man, just don't go by one couplet. When he says, Aye Ushak, gaye vaada-e farda lekar, ab dhundo ne rukhe zeba lekar. Ya bio kudo jo episode ahe, jay mein chaves to Jibrail, Allah to unsa, पंहिंजो इबलीस सां इबलीस जो मकालमो त यारे कदीम कोन कॾहिं वापसि ईंदे कॾहिं तौबा कंदे कॾहिं वापसि ईंदे त हू चवेसि थो त मैं खटकता हूं दिले जज़्दा में कांटे की तरह तूं फ़क़ति अलाह 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 तुंहिंजो मूंसां कहिड़ो मुक़ाबिलो आहे. फस्ट वर्ल्ड वॉर खां पोइ सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर में दुनिया में देर हैव बीन सो मैनी चेंजिस physical, material, psychological, sociological, currents, undercurrents, overcurrents. We had Hitler, we had Stalin, all had made their own contribution to the world, whatever we have now. And during those days, people were facing so many wave after wave thoughts from Western world, from Eastern world. You have been talking about Tolstoy, about Rabindranath Tagore. Now, Tagore's poetry was totally romantic poetry. It had no message for change. And he was translated by an English poet himself, William Yeats, W.B. Yeats, and therefore it got Nobel Prize. Otherwise, pure music, pure originality of thought, it did not contribute much to the freedom fight of India. Well, the national anthem, Vande Mataram, was given by somebody else, Chalamantam was given by Tagore. Well, everybody was doing his own best, everybody. So let us understand the times. Let us not waste our time in comparative study of persons, saying that man was great, this man was not great. It doesn't give any sense of direction to us. My interest in literature is confined to my father's keeping his memories alive, that's all. As much as my friend Yavar Kazmi Sahib, he will never be an artist, I know. He has devoted his life to his father's memories. And that's the only way he can do. If he becomes artist, then who will care for his father? 1978 photograph showing my father happy and me also. And I had come from first visit of Saudi Arabia to Pakistan, and that picture is a memory of that happy period.
The journey of Muhammed Usman Diplai Saheb in the field of literature was not an easy one. He strived to bring improvements in the society that he saw. He figured out the root causes for the sufferings to the common folks and pinpointed the evils. Consequently, harsh conditions met his way. Many of his books were banned, many confiscated, and he was imprisoned 3 times in less than a decade. Going through the tough times, Sir Muhammed Usman Diplai continued to learn and evolve, but never bowed to the tyranny. The battles that he fought went beyond the journalism and his writing beyond the ink. The impressions of his work remain permanent in the characters of countless hearts and minds. Many of his books have been republished time and again and continue that way. Sir Muhammed Usman Diplai departed on 7th February 1981. He will always be remembered as a brave son of the motherland Indus.